एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द कॉर्नरस्टोन ऑफ साइंटिफिक पब्लिकेशन इंटरनेशनल वेबिनार सीरीज पावर्ड बाय इनोवेटिव एजुकेशन एंड साइंटिफिक रिसर्च फाउंडेशन इन कोलैबोरेशन विद इनोवेटिव पब्लिकेशन. इफ यू आर हैविंग एनी डिफिकल्टीज रिगार्डिंग द ऑडियो एंड वीडियो ऑफ दिस वेबिनार देन प्लीज लेट अस नो थ्रू कमेंट एंड क्वेश्चन बॉक्स. वी विल हेल्प यू. प्लीज चेक योर ऑडियो एंड वीडियो setting before we start. Today's session is comprises four sessions: introduction to ISRF to innovative publication, introduction to the key speakers, presentation by key speakers, question answer session, and thanks for vote. Today's topic is very important, and the topic name is evolution of research analysis from bibliometric to altmetrics. Today's speakers are, first of all, I would like to introduce Innovative Publication is a publisher in medical, dental, pharmacy, nursing and allied sciences. Innovative publishes high quality peer-reviewed open access article in all specialties. Here are some reasons to publish with Innovative and experience the exceptional services. To know more, please visit www.ipinnovative.com. And for submitting your manuscript, please visit www.innovpub.org. Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation is the non-profit organization and working with the goal to help researcher fraternity to disseminate their research globally by publishing in peer review journals, by presenting in conference, research talk, seminar, webinar, etc. Our main aim is to promote the scientific research globally and provide a platform to community that tends to improve the visibility of work internationally. ISRF is an association of more than 3,000 members. For more information in details, please go through our website www.iasrf.org. Today's key speaker is Dr. Amina Sultan. She is BDS, MDS, Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry, Professor and Head of Department at Department of Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry, Faculty of Dentistry, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. She has numerous publications and presentations to her credit and has presented paper in various prestigious national and international conferences. Some of her oral presentations have won Best Presentation Awards as well. She is associated with many influential national and international journals as an editorial board member and a reviewer. She is a life member of several new renowned associations like Indian Society of Periodontics and Preventive Dentistry, South Asian Association of Pediatric Dentistry, Indo-Pacific Academy of Forensic Odontology, and Indian Society of Dental Traumatology. Our other speaker is Dr. Nitika Singh. She is an academician, she is BDS, MDS, Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry. She is an academician, experience of 8 years, and is currently working as an associate professor at Bhojia Dental College Hospital, Badi, Himachal Pradesh. She is also a life member of Indian Society of Periodontics and Preventive Dentistry, South Asian Association of Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry, India. She is an active speaker at many national and international conferences and has a chaired scientific session on the international platform. She has made contribution in dental literature through the article and case reports. Welcome, Dr. Amina Sultan. Welcome, Dr. Nitika.
Thank you. Thank you so much,
Thank ma'am. You so much, ma'am.
I request all the participants here, if you have any question, ask them in a question box at the bottom of your screen. We will try to answer as many as any question we can. If somehow we could not answer your questions due to some time constraint, then you will email, you can email us your question at info@ipinnovative.com or editor@iesrf.com. Thank you. So now I would like to invite Dr. Amina for share her presentation.
Good evening and greetings to all. I welcome you all to this Cornerstone of Scientific Publication Part 3 on behalf of Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation. Now, evaluating a research itself is a very difficult and a tedious process. After an article is published, how much influence does it has in the research field? We are all intrigued. We also want to know, how can we measure the impact of an article? Now, for this, bibliometric and altmetrics are the answers. And these parameters or the metrics are not just limited to the research articles or any academic material. Rather, it can be used for the books, conferences, policy statement, and even patent. Fine. So today evening, the topic of our presentation is evolution of research analysis from bibliometrics to altmetric. Myself, Dr. Amina, and my co-presenter, Dr. Nitika Singh, will be discussing both of them in different parts. Fine. Now, we know that peer review has always been a mainstay for science, any research evaluation for nearly a research now. Now, what do you mean by the peer review? It's a process of subjecting an author, scholarly work, research, or ideas to the scrutiny of others who are expert in that field. Peer review has lots and lots of advantages, but I can just summarize briefly into 3 points. It validates our work. Fine, the suggestion given by or the recommendation given by the various reviewers in our field helps us in improving the quality. And as a result, this also develops a network between the author and the researcher and the publisher. It helps in bringing up the closeness among us so that we can learn. This process should not stop at the peer review itself. Now, we all know this peer review process of 3 types. I will not go into the detail of this. This might have been discussed in previous presentation, but broadly it is open access, single blind, and double blind. Both, all 3 of them, they have their pros and cons, as the name suggests. Now, even peer review has been a mainstay for a very long time. The editorial peer review has certain flaws, I can say, that this is largely untested and its effects are very uncertain. The most important, all the papers which are accepted or which are sent for the publication, they are accepted without any detecting any major errors, their durability, their credibility, and sometimes the plagiarism is also not detected. Now, the most important point which has been argued against this peer review is that it limits the creativity among the researchers, because sometimes we repress certain ideas, certain new innovative techniques, or you can say bold question. As a result, we can't get a paradigm shift in a research and evolving field. And we all know this peer review process is a very time consuming process. We devote a large amount of our time, academic time, in reviewing an article thoroughly. Fine, that time we could have utilized it for our own writing a manuscript, and it is unpaid. And then another most important criticism, or you can say drawback with peer review, as the time is passing, there's a lot of pressure on the authors for the whatever reason, for the promotion or the accreditation, that we have to get more papers published. As a result, there's a lack or scarcity of competent reviewer, I can say. The fewer reviewers are available as compared to the number of articles which are sent for the reviewing. And the most important, I should not miss, the one reviewer suggestion and the recommendation may not match the recommendation, the suggestion given by the other reviewer. They can be a point of conflict also. So the results are not reproducible. And it doesn't involve the scientific conferences review process. Now, with current trends of the increasing scientific publication per year and increase in the technical and specialized part, many qualified reviewer boards and the reviewers, they are shifting to bibliometric to help and to validate this review process more effectively and in lesser time. Now, this, what is bibliometric? Now, this term was initially coined by Pritchard in 1969. It involved the mathematical and statistical methods to all the published articles, whether in a book chapter or in a, you can say, journal article or a newspaper, any communication written or communication you do, that is, it's analyzed through certain metrics. So you can say it is a potential tool and remove all the biases. It extracts the data from the publication, whatever we have published, all the data are extracted, and then these are evaluated, analyzed, and this gives an idea about the impact of that article in a scientific field. Now, why it is important? Because when we use it very responsibly, it can reduce the biases. It is transparent and reproducible. Like what one bibliometric indicator will indicate for a paper published in India or in any journal, that can be given same kind of this thing will be calculated for some other author in some other part of the world. So it can also help in guiding the review process, and we can get a roughly the impact of a scientific research. So bibliometric indicators can be broadly divided into three kinds. They are quantitative, that measure the productivity of a researcher, the number of publication, and the performance, that measure the quality, the citation indirectly you can say of the journal or the researcher. And the third is the structure bibliometric indicator that establishes a link between a publication, authors, and a research peer. Now in this presentation, I'll be covering only the quantitative and the performance-based bibliometric indicators. Now first I start with the quantitative indicators. This is the simplest way of knowing any scientific output of an author. Fine, it is just counting the number of paper that author has published in an article or in a newspaper or a chapter. Even an author himself or herself can count the number of publication and give us an idea. Now you can say this is a rough bibliometric indicator. Now since this deal with only the quantity, doesn't give about the quality of the author. Fine, doesn't have a quality, what quality the paper had. So it has certain pitfalls. It just deal with the quantity. And the most important, in multi-authored article, this is an era of collaboration between authors of the same university, different university, or different part of the world. So we don't know how much contribution each individual author has made in preparation of that manuscript. Fine. Now these can be overcome to certain extent if we know the what kind of article has been published, whether it is like in a medicine and dentistry, whether it is a case report, or it is a retrospective study, or is a clinical study. Now all these kinds, they carry different weightage, so we can indirectly know the quality of that presentation or the paper publication. Also we can count the publication which have been published in a good quality or high impact journals. Fine, we can publish in any, it's open, but your quality of your publication will be counted by the number of paper you have published in a high index or very well reputed journals. Now second comes the performance based indicator, which I'll be covering in quite detail. Now this performance based indicators can be general performance indicator that measure just the quality of the journals, or it can be a researcher's performance indicator of an individual researcher and author, and helps to quantify the quality of the article published by the researcher and the impact of those articles in a scientific community. Now all these performance indicators, they are governed by article based metrics or journal based metrics. Fine, in journal based metrics, then again we have three kinds of metrics which can decide about an article, that is the citation, download, and the F1000 or the faculty 1000 rating. Now citation is the key metrics. Whenever we apply for any job or any promotion, number of citation is a very primary feature of promotion. Fine, it's a potential tool in the recruitment, in the assessment of a career, on the NEC accreditation, on the university ranking. Now all bibliometric indicators are built on this idea only of citation, because this gives the idea about the quality of the paper. We can say in a layman term that it's a vote of confidence. Fine, that how influencing your study has been. The more the number of article has citation, that means the study has more impact in the scientific community. But again, citation has a drawback. We don't take into consideration whether it is a self-cited or the article has been cited, what kind of a journal. Fine, if the paper has been cited in a highly impact journal, then the quality is further reinforced. Whether it has been self-cited, whether the author himself or herself have cited his previous papers. Now these things also affects the impact. Fine. Then comes the download. The number of time an article has been downloaded from the publisher website, the journal website, or any source such as PubMed or any publicly available repository. This gives a number, and all these are recorded in a counter, which is an acronym of counting online usage of network electronic resources. Fine, now this number of downloads will again give the make how popular that article is. But again, this will not give us an idea whether that article which was downloaded, was it for the read purpose only, or it has been used in the further publication. Then come the F1000 or the faculty 1000 rating. This is the post-publication review system. When the article has been published, then it is circulated amongst us, amongst the peer, and we review. And then we can use the term like whether it can be recommended for further reading to other peers, or it can be must read for all, or an exceptional. Again, these scores are translated into a number which is termed as a F1000 article factor. Then come the journal level metrics, which can be citation, as I told you, that is the key metrics, or it can see the backbone, or the you can say vote of confidence. Then come the journal impact factor, 5-year journal impact factor, immediacy factor, and cited half-life. I'll be covering journal impact factor in little detail, but you should be aware of what is a 5-year impact factor and immediacy and cited half-life. Now, journal impact factor was first proposed by E. Garfield in 1955, and later on he worked on it further and later developed it more in a better way in collaboration with Scher in 1960s. And I think everybody who has published an article or who's related to this journal as an editorial board member, they are all aware of journal impact factor. Whenever we send a manuscript for publication, we ask iska manuscript, like iska journal impact factor kya hai. Theek hai, so this is a very crucial, you can say it defines the reputation of a journal in your specialization. Now this number is not constant, it varies yearly, and it is database and year specific, and in usually the journal citation report, it gives in decimals. Like suppose for a particular journal, is a random journal I picked, the JCR was 3.21219. Fine. So if you come across such kind of number, decimal, after the decimal there are 3 digits, that means that number is authenticated, because sometimes these numbers are fabricated, these are false. So one should be very careful when deciding a journal for publication. Now what are the, as I discussed, what is the uses of this impact factor? Now, in a as a researcher, as an author, it will help in choosing a journal where I can send, or it can help me choosing a journal if you want to read something related to a particular field. It will help in the management of library journal collection, right? More better collection, better impact will be have, better readers you will get. It will help in the editorial policies. The like who are in the publishing house, they know how impact factor is important to them. And the most important, it will help in making a evaluation of the research so that these policies can be applied further. Now, who are responsible for calculating the journal impact factor? Self-declaration is not valid. There are agencies responsible like Thomson Reuters, Institute for Scientific Research, Journal Citation Report, which I just mentioned, JCR, which is most commonly used by the publishers or the journals, and the Scopus and so on. Like, for example, if you want to know any journal impact factor, you can go to the Web of Science site and you can search the journal name, put the name in the journal search engine, or that will automatically will give you the updated list of the article in the arranged descending order of the impact factor, so that this can help you in choosing a journal for a publication. Now, how it is calculated? Now, in a given year, I just think if anybody can read this line, it's a very simple explanation. Now, in a given year, the impact factor of a journal is the number of citations received in that year from the articles which were published two preceding year to, of that year. For example, if you want to know the impact factor of 2006, then the citation received in 2006 from the publication made in 2004 and 5, two preceding year, and divided by the total publication received in 2004 and 5. This will give you a number, and that will define your journal impact factor. Now, another example, journal impact factor of 2019, two preceding year citation 2018 and 2017, and the article published, total article published in 2018 and 17. Suppose I put the random number and the impact factor came out to be 6.228. Fine. So it means if you want to know the impact factor of 2020, then it will be shown in the next succeeding year, that is 2021, in the month of September or October. Now, there are certain limitations. It is just calculated for a very short of period of time, like 2 years. Journal impact factor will take only the two preceding year. Now, it is open to manipulation. Now, all the authors or the publishers or the editors, they know the impact factor is a pulling effect. it will attract more authors, more researchers to your journal, so they can manipulate this impact factor. How they can manipulate? They will accept only those articles which they feel which have a higher probability of getting published or cited, or they will accept only the review articles or the clinical trials, or they will accept lesser number of articles. They will keep the denominator low. As a result, that will impact their impact factor by increasing it. Now, despite all this limitation, impact factor has still maintained the prominence in the journal field and is one of the most important metrics used in ranking, comparison a journal, and helps in choosing a journal. Now, this journal impact factor calculated for a 2 year, like for a 2009, the 2009 is a reference period, and we take the 2 year citation window, two preceding year, 2007 and 8. Now, there are certain specialties like economics, social science, where the articles take some time to be noticed and cited. For them, this journal impact factor will not be so appreciable. Now, for this, we use a bigger citation window. For example, we want to know the 5 year impact factor for 2009. So we take the 5 preceding years from 2009. As a result, it will more cover the better citation of the article and give a appreciable journal impact or the journal impact factor of 5 years. For example, the same journal, in the 2010, the journal impact factor, the article cited 66 for the last 2 years, that is 2008 and 9, and the number of article published in 2008 and 9, 43. The impact factor, journal impact factor, is 1.535. Now, for the same journal, 5 year journal impact factor, when they took the citation for the last 5 years and the total publication for the last 5 years, and this comes out to be 4.213. Now, see, the number is different. Fine, the ranking of the journal may be unaffected, but the value of the journal impact factor and the 5 year impact factor is different. So whenever we choose a journal and any impact factor is mentioned, just make sure whether it is a journal impact factor for the 2 years or it is a 5 year impact factor. Then come the immediacy index. It is just like the year you publish an article and that article gets cited in the same year. It gives the current importance of the work published by a journal. It will indirectly, this immediacy index will give an idea which journals are dealing with the evolving or the emerging areas of the research. How it is calculated is very simple. You calculate the number of time article published in that specific journal cited by the other in a particular year, and the total number of the article published in that same year. For example, in 2010, total article published were 404, and they were cited 386 times in 210 itself. Though the number of citation were 386 in 2010 and the publication were 404, then the immediacy index comes out to be 0.0.955. Fine, then come the cited half-life. You know, you get abundance of mails. They might be lying in your spam folder. That the journal publisher, they're inviting you to send your publication to a very richly involving journal. They're giving you these ideas. We have this. Fine. These are kind of a pulling effect. And they are bragging about their citation. They have thousands of citation, hundred of citation. Now, they might be having 100 and 1,000 citation, but we have to see that those 100 citation or thousands of citation were achieved in what time? Fine. It calculates the cited half-life. It calculates the median article publication. It calculates, count all the journal citation of that particular calendar year. For example, 2020, total citation achieved in 2020. Then we calculate the median article publication date and the half article which are published before that time and half the article which were published afterward. Fine. So in the 50% of article that were published before that half median date, that will be the cited half-life. Now, for example, in 2010, suppose a journal says that this half cited half-life is 10.6 years. That means 50% of the citation received at the journal in 2010 refer to the article that were published in past 10.6 years, that is around 2009. Fine. Though shorter the cited half-life, that means those articles were published and immediately cited. Usually, whether that journal was newly started journal or there was some blockbuster publication in that particular year that attracted so many citation, or they were publishing those short communication letter to the editor, they're cited very fast, very quickly they are picked up by the other authors, or whether they are dealing with those research which are richly and recently evolving. Fine. Whereas the long cited half-life, they reflect either the emphasis on the archival literature, which is a past literature, or in a lowly evolving field. They will get citation, but that will, you know, certain fields take time to be cited. Although this cited half-life, it is very misleading. One should not get misguided about it. But this can help the editors in changing the editorial policy if they want to improve their citation. Then come the agent factor. Now the impact factor, general impact factor, was taking into the total citation, fine, and the total number of the publication. But it was not considering where those articles were cited, fine. It was not taking into the consideration of those journals which has cited those articles. That agent factor takes into consideration of that quality of the citing journal. The journals which had cited those article published in that particular journal, what was the impact factor of that journal? Higher the impact factor of those journals that had cited those publications, better will be your agent factor. Fine. Now, the reference from one article in a journal to another article from the same journal are removed. Fine. This will remove the citation in that particular journal of the article published in that particular journal, and it will remove the cell citation. So this has a very significant role, and these days these values are being written on the journal along with the journal impact factor. Now this is algorithm based, nothing difficult to calculate. You go to this website and it is freely available, and this gives you two scores. There's an agent factor score that gives the overall value provided by all the article published in a given journal in a year, and it is an article influence score, that particular article, what was the prestige of that article, how it was cited in other journal. It will just map, it will give the time a reader depend on that particular journal, fine. So it is just, it's an important factor, even if not used by various universities in ranking or NIF ranking, but one should know about this agent factor also. Now come the researcher performance indicator. There are direct indicators like total publications, I told you the quantity, number of papers, co-authorship, how many papers you have written with other authors, or how many you have the single author publication, and the citation count. The next is the derived indicators. Now, derived indicators may be highly cited papers that refer to those papers of an author that are among the top 10% of the most cited papers worldwide. We have to calculate, we have to find the threshold for that 10% article and see if our article or that author article lie in that category. Now, more the highly cited paper of an author, high impact that research output that author has. Then come the average citation per paper. It is again the ratio of the total citation to the total publication, and is formulated by this formula. Then come the international collaborated paper. It refers to those paper which have at least, they might be only two authors, but at least one author, the other author should be some other country, fine. Or they may be multi-authored, but at least single author should be from another country outside your native country. This again gives an impact how influential you are in collaborating your research. More minds will be involved, more different centers will be involved in conducting a study, will have a better impact. Fine. This is a list of the various letters which I picked from the Google Scholar public profile. And this is a list of top authors, but some of them are deceased also. But these lists get updated every year in the month of April. Now I'll be taking care of the research metrics. I'll be covering only three research metrics, the H index, I10 index, and G10 index. Now H index, now this everybody amongst us are aware of is H index. Whenever we go for an interview, I know they will ask you, what is your H index? Okay. Now this was given by George E. Hirsch in 2007. Some papers say have cited it 2006. Okay. So the H index is basically after that author, that is the Hirsch index, and it's the most acceptable, most easily understood, and most objective indicator so far. And the single number, X number, will tell the quality and the productivity, the quantity and the quality of an author. Fine. Now, this can be used by an individual assessment, or this can be used for the various universities, ranking of the institute and the countries and the scientific journal. Now, it George Ehrhardt defined H index as a researcher has H index if his H and paper have at least H citation, and the rest of the papers minus the H index have less than H citation. Now, to make you more easily understood, I'll explain it in an example, working example before. But before we proceed, I just want to know how to find it H index. They can be automatically calculated by Google Scholar, Web of Science, and Scopus. Fine. Now, we should be aware that all these three databases, the H index of any author may not match. Usually, the Google Scholar, the H index is much higher as compared to the Scopus in the Web of Science, because Google Scholar take into consideration everything which is published. Fine. It also takes the latest and the recent publication, whereas Scopus and Web of Science, they are more involved in an academic assessment. So therefore, the number doesn't mismatch. So anyway, whenever you mention your H index or the university asks for the promotion, the H index, there should be a clarification which database have been used to calculate that H index. Now, in a study by Fahadi H. et al. And published in Australian Journal of Basic and Applied Science, the authors found out that the mean of H index for the various Nobel Prize winners, when they were assessed, it was found that in the Google Scholar database, the mean in H index was much higher. It was 62.558 for those group of scientists, whereas the same group of authors or the scientists had lesser mean H index in Web of Science, which was 23.5, and in Scopus, it was 39.25. So this signifies that we have to clarify which database has been used to calculate one's H index. Now, another point to be considered in calculating an H index is that it should not be used to compare the different disciplines. There are different specialties, different fields. They have different way of writing a paper, different way of doing the study. So it is not fair to match them. And second, most important, it is time and experience dependent. More mature the person or researcher is, higher the H index the person will have. So whenever we are calculating H index or during interpretation of the H index, we should also give consideration to the age and experience while comparing the H index of different researchers. Now, H index mean for the chemistry, but the same study, same list of authors, they did another study and found out that the mean H index for the chemistry was 59.17 as compared to physics, which was 37.5, and for the economics, it was the least, that is lesser as compared to them, that is 31.67. Again, this signifies that the citation and publication in chemistry area is more than those of physics and economics. So when we are doing comparison of H index of these two authors, it is very unfair. Fine, in chemistry is already much higher. They have higher tendency of getting cited. Now, H index, it's calculated by if we arrange all the publication in a descending order of the citation, fine, and the number of papers on the x-axis. Now, as we move down, we reach to a particular point where we find that the number of paper and the citation are equal, or where the number of paper is, the citation is more than the number of the paper, equal to or more than the paper. Fine, suppose if say ki the person has H index of 5, that means 5 number of papers have been cited at least 5 times. It is 5 or more than 5 times. Now, this H index can also be calculated manually. It's very simple. This is one author which had 12 publications, and these were the number of the citation each individual paper received. Now, we arrange these papers in a descending order of the citation. Fine. Now, as we see, the rank 1 paper had the highest citation, 39. So, we can say the rank 1 paper had at least one citation. The rank 2 paper had 36, so we can say it has at least 2 citations. So as we move down and down, and we read the paper rank number 8, the rank number 8 paper has 9 citations, whereas just below the rank 8 paper, the rank 9 paper has 7 citations. So the H index for this researcher is 8, because 8 number of his paper has at least 8 citations or more than 8 citations. So we randomly count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. See, 8 papers of this author had more than 8 citations. The H index for this author is 8. Fine. Now we can use this H index in comparing the research output of various researchers in the same field, we can come to know which researcher is doing better than the others. Now the researcher one, they are arranged in the descending order. Researcher two, the citation arranged in the descending order. Similarly, researcher three. Now in the researcher one, the rank one paper had 11 citations. And as we move down, the rank six paper has 6 citations. And just below six, rank seven paper had only 1 citation. The H index for this author was 6. Now come to the researcher two. The rank one paper has 130 citation, rank two has 90. As we move down to rank five paper, it has only 9 citation, and just below rank six paper had 5 citation. Now the researcher two has an H index of 5. Now this will give, if you look very deeply into this, will give us an idea. Although this researcher, the amount of citation was very less, but he managed to get H index better than this, because this author, he had only one blockbuster cited article, whereas he was not consistent with other publication. As a result, he could manage to get H index of 5. Now the researcher 3, he was a moderate, rank 1 paper 35, and is moved down to rank 5 paper, it has 7 citation. Rank 6 paper has 2 citation. Fine, so the researcher 3rd, the H index was 5. Now see, there's a such a difference, huge difference in these two researchers citation output, but both of them have H index of the same. So from this we can get an inference. Now if this author published more papers with a better scientific output as published before, as he was publishing one of his paper, then his H index can improve much better than the rest of two researchers. Fine. Then come the I-10 index. I-10 index is very simple. It calculates the number of papers with more than 10 citations. It's simple and straightforward. We can calculate how many papers we had, paper with more than 10 citations. Now the disadvantage is that this is a Google Scholar feature. No other database calculates the I-10 index. And if you want to know your I-10 index, you should have a Google Scholar profile. If you have a Gmail ID, you create your profile and you can add your papers, and automatically on the My Citation page, you will come to know I-10 index. Now this I-10 index can also be calculated manually. We arrange all the citation in descending order, the same author, and see the rank one paper at 39. Fine, at least 10 papers were more than 10. As we move down, rank 7 has 21 paper, the rank 8 has 9 citation. So we can say the I-10 index for this author is 7. 7 paper were cited at least 10 times or more than 10 times. Now we can again use this I-10 index for comparison for the amongst the various researchers in the same field. Same database I have used, which I used for the calculation of H index. In this author, the rank 1 paper had 11 citations, whereas rank 2 had 9, that is less than 10. So in this, the I-10 index was 1. H index was 6, but the I-10 index was 1. Now researcher 2, the rank 4 paper has 14 citations, whereas the rank 5 paper had 9 citations. The I-10 index was 4. So he could grab better I-10 index as compared to this researcher. Now the researcher, that's the reason of significance of applying various metrics to an author if you want to do any assessment of a researcher. Then researcher 3, the rank 4 paper had 12 citations and the rank 5 paper has 7 citations. That means I-10 index is 4. 4 paper of this researcher were cited at least more than 10 times. If this author works better in publishing an article in a that can pulls better citation, which has better significance clinically, then can improve his I-10 and H index 4. Now come the last index, that is the G index. Now G index was proposed by Leo Egge in his paper Theory and Practice of G Index as an improvement of H index. Why there was a need to improve improvement of H index? See, while calculating the H index, you must have realized H index take into consideration only the H number of citation. The paper which were, the author might have more than H H number of papers, but the cited paper which were cited less or which were not cited at all, that were not considered in calculating the H index. Whereas the G index, the main advantage is that it takes into consideration all the papers, the paper which were highly cited, highly inflated index, and the paper which had lower citation or zero citation. Everything will be taken into calculation of this G index, and this is calculated as a unique largest number by the top G articles together. That is, summation of all the citation is at least G square citation. At least, matlab it is equal to or it is more than G square citation. Now, to make it easily understand, I'll just give an example working example. Now, the same database I have used, which I use for the calculation of H index, ITIN index, we have arranged the 10 paper of this author in the descending order of the citation. Now we add two more columns, summation of the citation and the square of the rank. Take in the rank one paper, the summation was 65, square of the rank was 1. And the rank two paper, summation was 65 plus 15 more 80. And the rank was, square of the rank was 4. So as we move down, some last two papers had two citation or zero citation, but that have been included in the summation. The rank 10 paper had summation of citation was 115 and square of the rank was 100. Now we come to this column. Now I ask, in this column, if the summation of the citation is at least or larger than the square of the rank, in the rank 1 paper, yes, summation is more than the rank. Similarly, in the rank 2 paper, it is yes. So as we move down and down and we reach to the rank 10 paper, the square of the rank was 100 and the summation was 115. Fine. Even if he had published more paper, whether with zero citation or no citation at all, but it's just freshly published, that could have been also included. But he had only 10. So you know the G index for this author is 10. So you know it has taken into consideration the entire citation value of that author. Again, we can calculate it manually. Same author. Fine, where we had calculated the H index and the ITIN index, we have added two more columns, summation of the citation and the rank square. In the rank 1 paper, summation is 29, rank square is 1. So as we move down the 12th rank paper, the summation is 146 and the rank square is 144. So we can safely say the rank 12 paper, the summation citation together or summation is at least 144. That it is at least or more than 144, that is 146. The G index for this researcher is 12. Now G index, again, it can be used to calculate the differences in the working, the significance of the various researchers in their field, or who is doing better than the other. Again, the same database I have used, which I use for the H index. In this, see, summation, rank 1 paper was 11, rank square was 1. As we move down, rank 6 paper, summation was 144 and the rank square was 36. Now, just below the rank 6 paper, the rank 7 paper, summation was 47 and the square of the rank was 49. Now, this summation is less than the square of the rank. So, this is not, this number is not the G index. The G index will be 6. Rank 6 paper had the summation or the citation together 44, which is at least or more than the rank square. Now in the researcher 2, which had very higher citation amount, fine. Now as we move down, the rank 8 paper, citation was 1. Summation came out to be 326 and rank square is 64. The G index for this author is 8, fine. And you can see there's a huge difference between the summation and the rank square. So this again gives us an idea. If this researcher focuses on publishing more articles and in better with better citation, it will improve his H index and it will improve his G index also. Now in the researcher 3rd, the 8 rank paper, the summation was 110 and the rank square was 64. There is a difference. Again, if this author published better articles with better citation, or even if no citation, his G index can improve. The G index is 8 for both this author, although there's a huge difference in their citation score. Now with this, I just want to conclude my presentation by summarizing. See, whenever we come across any article, or we want to do any assessment, it is always recommended to all of us that we should measure the quality of the scientific journal where it has been published, find the research group and the particular researcher who has done. through several indicators. Not a, just a simple or a single indicator will give a idea or a, about it, impact, scientific impact of a study or an author. We should have a good understanding. You'll be given a platter or a basket full of various kind of a metrics. We should know which metrics to have to be applied where and how it was constructed. Fine, there might be an author with an H index of 4, there might be an author H index 5 or 6, they might be same field. We have to see how much experience both of them have or what is this scope of their specialization. Then comparison, we know it's unfair or very ridiculous to compare oranges with apple. So bibliometric indicator should also not be used for comparing researchers or the researcher group or the journal from the different field. And I think with this, you can take home simple message from this presentation. Don't take this ranking too literally. Fine, we should just focus on writing and sending papers to the journal which have a better and good impact, which are they are related to your specialty. Fine, always take this ranking with a pinch of salt. Don't confuse the journal metrics with an article-based metrics. And sometimes we have to use a common sense. CK, thank you so much, everyone, for your patient listening. Now, with this, I would invite Dr. Nitika Singh to continue with the altmetrics part of this presentation. Thank you. Over to you, Nitika.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this knowledgeable webinar, and it was great. And now I'll start with the next part of metrics. Good evening, everybody. And ma'am has just very beautifully elaborated what bibliometrics and all the metrics associated with bibliometrics are. So I'll be covering the next step, that is altmetrics. Now, altmetrics is basically alternative metrics. So altmetrics, these are the metrics and the qualitative data that are complementary to the traditional citation-based metrics, which ma'am has just elaborated in this meeting. And these include peer reviews on faculty of 1,000, citations on Wikipedia and public policy documents, discussions on research blog, mainstream media coverages, bookmarks like bookmarks on reference managers like Mendeley, mentions on social network like Twitter and Facebook, right? So all these sources from the web are all calculated using altmetrics. And that is why, for this reason, altmetrics has now been incorporated into research websites also, many institutional repositories also, and even in journal websites also, right? So it is a non-traditional way, and it mentions how an article was approached in an academic social circle like the mainstream media, Twitter, or the scientific blogs or Mendeley, right? It focuses on the individual article rather than the complete article. So as we already know that in today's genera, internet and web plays a very, very important and a crucial role. Earlier times, people used to sit and talk and discuss things over the table. But nowadays, with the click of the laptop, the ideas and ideologies flow from not only one person to the other person, but probably from one country to the other country, right? So the same way, the reviewing process has also accelerated using this web as a platform. So altmetrics can be done by individuals also using a software. And there are also third parties which can help you give the altmetrics score, like altmetric.com, Noes, Plum Analytics, Qdos, and Impact Story. So what does altmetric do basically, right? So the first thing is it basically records the attention which your scholarly output or your research product has received, right? And how many people around the globe have been exposed to that research output or scholarly that scholarly output, and how much they have engaged in it. Again, this can be counted through mentions in the news, blogs, Twitter, page views, and also downloads. It also helps to measure dissemination. By that we mean that why and where the piece of research was discussed and shared. Again, the data is covered through news, blogs, and social sharing on the medias. Also, it is a very good indicator of the influence and impact of your scholarly output or your research product, right? So some of the data gathered via altmetrics can signal that research is changing a field of study. So what the impact of your research output has on that particular field of study or on the public health or on larger aspect of the society, right? Now this data again is gathered through the policy documents or through commentary from the experts or the practitioners. Now, before getting into detail of altmetrics, let me just compare it with bibliometrics, right? So in bibliometrics, citation plays a very, very major role. Whatever is the score or the metric score is generated, it usually revolves around the citations. The number of articles which were viewed, discussed, or saved, that doesn't matter, right? And even the audience is the scholarly audience. The public in general are not taken into consideration for measuring the bibliometrics. Whereas, on contrary, altmetrics take all these things into consideration. Your research output, which was recommended or even viewed or saved or downloaded or scholarly was stated, all these things are accounted for altmetric score, right? And here, the audience is the scholarly audience also, plus the general public also. So altmetrics is a quicker way to accumulate your score as compared to the normal citation-based metrics. And it can capture the diverse impacts which your study or your research has made on the person or society or an institute or a country as compared to the citation-based method. And it applies to much more and many more platforms and not just the books or the journals. So this is altmetric donut. Before coming on to the altmetric attention score, let me first give you a brief what altmetric donut is. So altmetric donut is basically a visual representation of your score, right? And just by looking at the donut, you can very easily predict that what was the main source of that research output, right? Because as I said, that altmetrics takes into consideration various platforms, not only the academic platforms, but also the social platforms, the news, the blogs, the Twitters, the Facebook, the YouTube, everything. So all these platforms have been given a particular color. For example, the purple one is for the policy documents, the red for the news, yellow is for blogs, blue is for Twitter, white is for post-publication peer reviews. The dark blue one is for Facebook. The dark gray one is for syllabi and similar way. Like LinkedIn is light blue. Rust is for patents. Gray, dark gray is for YouTube, right? So all these have been color-coded. And the amount of color in each donut will change, as you can see in all these donuts. So the amount of color in each donut will change depending upon which source a research output has received maximum attention from. For example, in the donut in the uppermost right corner, having 252 attention score, it has red in predominance, right? And as we know, red is for news. So the attention it received from the media, and that is why it is more of red. The second one is more of a yellow, followed by a purple color. So the data or the attention was mainly received or retrieved from the blogs, right? And the policy documents. And the third one is more of a blue. So all the data for the attention score was received from the Twitter. So Twitter was the main source of collecting the data for this particular research, whichever was talked about on Twitter, followed by this gray zone of post-publication peer review. So this donut can give you in a very simple way that where your research output or where your research scholarly topic is being more discussed or more looked upon, correct? Now coming to the altmetric attention score. Now see, as I've already said, all these platforms, they have been given a color code. In a similar way, all these platforms, they have been giving a weighted count also. For example, you can see in this table on the left side, the news has a count of 8, blogs 5, policy documents per source 3, patents 3, Wikipedia 3, Twitter 1, peer review 1, Vibo 1, Google Plus 1, F1001, Syllabi 1, LinkedIn 0.5, Facebook 0.25, right? Pinterest 0.25. So this is the score which has been assigned to all these platforms. So try and understand this, how we calculate this, how the altmetric score is calculated. I will just give a very simple example. Like a product was introduced or a research was done how to prevent dental caries for special children. Right? So a product was introduced or researched upon and it was concluded that SDF, silver diamine fluoride, is very beneficial for special children and for uncooperative children, and their caries can be reduced drastically. So the end product was silver diamine fluoride. So now if this silver diamine fluoride product is talked about more on the news channel, right, or it is circulated among the national, around the nation through a newspaper, so it will get an altmetric score of 8, right? So if one news channel is giving it, the altmetric score stays at 8. Now if somebody takes up that link from the news channel and puts it in his or her blog, so then the score will become 8 plus 5. And eventually when institutions and colleges, when they recognize the usefulness of this product and they probably try to make it a patent of their own, or probably the person who himself had researched it makes it a patent and drafts a policy for the same, and that policy comes, so the score becomes 8 plus 5 plus 3. Right. So somewhere if somebody in Twitter again shares that link from the news, so it 1 plus 1 will get added again. So that is how the altmetric will measure the effect of your research product. Right. Also on the scholarly audience and also in public in general. Right. But altmetric score again depends on 3 things. It depends on volume. It depends on source. It depends on author. Right. So by volume, it means that count one mention for each person per score. So if you have tweeted the same thing thousands of times, it will still be considered as score 1, right? For the same person. For the source, if I say, newspapers are said to be more authentic than as compared to blogs or Twitter. So newspapers have more weightage as compared to all other platforms. And even if I talk about news, there are different tiers, right? So there is a national news channel or a national newspaper, and then there is a local news channel or a local newspaper. So the national news channel or the newspaper will have more weightage as compared to a local news channel or a local newspaper. And the third is author. So how often an author of each mention talks about the scholarly article, whether they are biased about that journal or publisher, is again linked to altmetric attention score. For example, if a dentist is sharing the SDF link on the on any platform for that matter, the score will be higher as compared to any random person who is sharing that link, right? So if the person of the same specialty or the same field or the same research field shares that link or shares that blog or news, it will hold more weightage as compared to any XYZ person doing the same, right? So this is how we mention the altmetric attention score. So hence it is very much beneficial for academicians who use social media to share their work and findings, and is also valuable for parties who wish to drive public awareness of new research findings. But again, it comes with few limitations. Now, what are the limitations? That altmetrics, they don't tell the whole story. So as I said, as we all know that bibliometrics, altmetrics, they all have some limitations. I'll be covering that in the next slide also, but they have to be used as an adjunct, right? With the peer review and the citation based metrics and not as a total replacement. Potential of gaining, yes, there is a high potential of gaining because tweets and blogs, they can be purchased also, and tweets and blogs can be removed overnight also. Then the third is inclusion of data from the public social media like Facebook and Twitter is again a potential problem. Reason being, who will authenticate which platform is better, whether Facebook is better or Twitter is better. So that is again an issue. lack of correct correlation between bibliometrics and altmetrics data. Now, score is related to representativeness. So mainly for altmetrics, only 5 social platforms are mainly used. That is Twitter, Mendeley, Facebook, site you like, and blogs, right? Mainly these are the 5 sites from where data is retrieved, and the others are not. And altmetrics takes into consideration only those sites which are in English language. So it uses language English. So the citations and the authors who deal in other traditional languages are usually neglected, or the score drops. So here I'll talk about what is, obviously each metric comes with a drawback. So we'll compare the drawbacks of bibliometrics and altmetrics. So bibliometrics is mainly influenced by database, and it can be easily manipulated also because of the personal touch. And you cannot compare one bibliometric, one metric meter with the other of different scientific fields, as ma'am just told. Like the metric reading or the citation index for a journal of Nature will be totally different from that or impact factor of a journal of biochemistry. So you cannot compare them with each other. And the most important thing is bibliometrics, it fails to take time into account. Now bibliometrics is totally citation based. Correct. So citations, it takes time for citations to develop. For a person who is a renowned author, is already there in the research field for a decade, he will have a lot of citations to his credentials. But for a new person who may be very good, maybe having innovative ideas, but obviously he's not into research that much, will have less citations. So the time factor plays a very major role when it comes to citations. And as for altmetrics, we know the quality of data cannot be very much authenticated on this site, because anything which is trending on the social media news or blogs, they cannot, it doesn't mean it is true or it adds some value, scientific value to that research, right? Manipulation, as I said, tweets and retweets, they are all purchased and they can be retracted also. Lack of theoretical background, little effort in an article can give a very hit overnight. So the altmetric meter or the altmetric attention score can rise within a night. Now that doesn't mean that research or that research output or that article was superb. It can just be because that article was on some trending topic, and that is why it took so many hits instantly. And the last thing, data used for commercialization on social media. Many a times the data or the scholarly articles which are there on the Facebooks and Twitters, they are used by people privately to promote their own products also, right? So this is again one of the drawbacks of altmetrics. Now tips for the researchers. As we've just known what in the previous one, we've known about peer review, then bibliometrics, and then altmetrics. So research is refining every single day. And so I believe even a researcher should refine himself with every single step, right? So one should create a unique researcher identifier to distinguish himself from the other researchers. You can make an ORCID ID by directly going on to http://orcid.org, and you can generate your own ORCID number. And also Scopus and Web of Science, it offers author disambiguation and allows you to search by unique identifiers. So these are very user-friendly sites which, as an author and a researcher, one should approach and make a profile for themselves. So these were the references which were used for this presentation. In case of any query, you can always go back to these articles which beautifully state what bibliometrics and altmetrics is all about. And thank you so much for sparing your valuable time. And I hope this session was a fruitful one. Thank you.